I do want to say a word about the series that her talk is a part of and a couple of words of thanks. So this event is sponsored by the Robert H. Taylor S.J. Chair in Philosophy, which is generously funding a series of talks this year and next year on the topic of virtue epistemology and the Ignatian spirituality and pedagogy. That is a series that looks at how personal character intersects with our intellectual or epistemic activities in ways that also bear on the practice of Ignatian spiritual exercises and Ignatian pedagogy. The event is also sponsored by the Academy for Catholic Thought and Imagination, and I'm very grateful to the Academy's director, Brian Trainer, and its ever-competent senior administrative coordinator, Kat Brown, for their generosity and helpfulness in preparing for and getting the word out about this event. Again, Nancy Snow is a professor of philosophy and director of the Institute for the Study of Human Flourishing at the University of Oklahoma, a post that she took up in the fall of 2015. Prior to that, Nancy was in the philosophy department at Marquette University for nearly 25 years, or
26.
26 years. She also received her PhD in philosophy from Notre Dame, so she knows a thing or two about Catholic and specifically Jesuit intellectual and spiritual traditions. Professor Snow works in the area of ethics, broadly construed, and one of the things that I appreciate about her work is how it integrates theoretical ethics with applied concerns, ranging from issues in medical research and food ethics, and the development or cultivation of virtue. And how it also integrates philosophy with other disciplinary perspectives like psychology, literature, and theology. She is author of dozens of peer-reviewed articles and author or editor of several books. Some of her recent book publications include Cultivating Virtue, Perspectives from Philosophy, Theology, and Psychology, published by Oxford in 2015. The Philosophy and Psychology of Character and Happiness, published by Routledge in 2014. Virtue as Social Intelligence, an Empirically Grounded Theory, 2010. She is also co-editor with Darsha Narvez from Notre Dame of a 15-volume series published by Oxford on individual virtues or clusters of virtues titled Becoming Virtuous. And this is a series that's aimed at a fairly general audience. The work Professor Snow has overseen at the Institute is staggering in quantity and extremely impressive in quality and reach. The Institute sponsors postdoctoral fellowships, conferences, dissertation fellowships, course development grants, faculty luncheons, faculty roundtable discussions, all surrounding the themes of advancing our scientific and philosophical understanding of virtue and promoting the development or cultivation of virtue at the University of Oklahoma, the broader Oklahoma community, and beyond. In the latter capacity, the Institute also is deeply engaged with leaders in education, business, and government, and with parents in the broader community of Norman and throughout Oklahoma at large. I spent a lot of time on the website this morning. If the sort of thing I just described and what Nancy talks to you about today is of interest, I recommend just Googling OU Flourishing Institute. It's a wealth of resources. So I'm very grateful to Nancy for taking the time out of what has to be an outrageously busy schedule to join us this afternoon. She will talk for 45 minutes more or less, and we'll have a Q&A session afterwards of about 30 minutes. Please join me in welcoming Professor Nancy Snow.
Thank you. Thank you, Jason, for that wonderful introduction. The check is in the mail. Thanks to everybody for coming out today. I want to give a special shout out to my good friend, Tim Shanahan. Tim and I went to graduate school together at Notre Dame back in the Pleistocene era. So it's really great to see you again. Let me get all my stuff together here. Okay, my standards for success are very low. So if I don't trip and fall, it's going to be a good presentation. Are we all okay with that? All right, good. So thanks again. Pardon? Oh, you're great. Thank you. Love it. Okay. So Jason asked me to do this. We brought him out to do curricular and assessment consultation for the Institute. And so, you know, I distinctly remember we were having lunch at a great Mexican restaurant. And he said, you know, he kind of brought it up casually. Oh, we have the series. You know, oh, you wouldn't want to do this, would you? And I said, well, sure. Seemed like a good idea at the time. Right? And then, you know, he wanted actual work. It's kind of like, whoa, what is this about? But anyway, long story short, we came up with this approach to the spiritual exercises and the virtues of introspection. And I will say that my views on this are evolving, and they have evolved considerably because I was invited to attend a very interesting luncheon sponsored by the Ignatian Postdoctoral Fellows. And there was a wonderful presentation by Jake Tuttle. Jake, where are you? Oh, you're there. Okay. Jake, can you see?
I, yes.
You can sit up here. There are seats up in front. Oh, you're okay? Okay. But this discussion was really inspiring, and so I'll probably include some comments along the way that occurred to me during this discussion or that, you know, brought some issues into focus that I hadn't quite thought of before. So anyway, we'll get started here. The aim of the presentation is to discuss how reading the exercises can exercise and cultivate a suite of intellectual virtues, which I call the virtues of introspection. So, you know, we have a little bit about Ignatius. I'm sure that you know this, but, you know, I just to be on the safe side, he was a Basque nobleman and soldier who was wounded by a cannonball, which broke his leg. That must have been one severe break. Okay. While he was recuperating, he read religious texts and experienced a religious conversion. So he founded the Society of Jesus with Saints Peter Faber and Francis Xavier in 1539, died in 1556, and was canonized in 1622. Just a little bit of history there. Okay, now the exercises. Here I plundered various internet resources so that I could get sort of an overview for you. The spiritual exercises are a compilation of meditations, prayers, and contemplative practices developed by St. Ignatius Loyola to help people deepen their relationship with God. For centuries, the exercises were most commonly given as a long retreat of about 30 days in solitude and silence. In recent years, there has been a renewed emphasis on the spiritual exercises as a program for lay people. The most common way of going through the exercises now is a retreat in daily life, which involves a months-long program of daily prayer and meetings with a spiritual director. The exercises have also been adapted in many other ways to meet the needs of modern people. And just as a personal comment on this, one of the associate deans in the College of Liberal Arts at OU is doing some work with students with peer mentoring, and she noticed that I was giving this talk and asked about it, and I sent her the PowerPoint, and we had a conversation about this, about how, you know, the kinds of attention and concentration that are needed for reading the exercises might be of use to students who are going through a certain kind of transition, going through some sorts of problems in their academic and personal lives. So there are all sorts of applications here that take us beyond the realm of spiritual development, you know, as it was conceptualized by Aquinas and in religious traditions, to other areas. So I think that this text is a very rich resource for, you know, thinking about ourselves and about growth and transformation. So there's a pattern to the exercises consisting of 4 weeks, each with its own spiritual gifts. Ignatius called them graces and challenges. So the exercises were supposed to be read in a retreat. Week 1 was self-awareness, week 2 self-giving, week 3 self-sacrifice, week 4 self-understanding. So I'm going to talk a little bit about this, and I have benefited from reading from the website of Marquette University some material about spiritual exercises, which was written by my good friend, Dr. Stephanie Russell, who was formerly the Executive Vice President of Mission and Ministry at Marquette and who is now a director of the AJCU. So week one, self-awareness, is longing to be known and loved by God, seeking spiritual freedom from what hinders our relationship with God. It's experiencing God's deep and endless love for us despite our failings and shortcomings, opening our heart to conversion from a focus on what is important to us to a focus on God's deep desires for our lives. Week two, self-giving, loving Christ intimately and grafting our life story to His, praying with our mind, our heart, and all our senses, our whole self, and hearing the call of Christ in our lives, becoming aware of the choices before us and discerning which leads us to a closer relationship with Christ. I'm going to talk about all of this more as we move forward. Week three, self-sacrifice, remaining with Christ in His suffering and death and allowing Him into our moments of suffering, experiencing the depth of Christ's sacrificial love. Week four, self-understanding, understanding our indissoluble relationship to Christ and all of creation, living with a resurrected spirit of hope, revisiting the graces of the previous 3 weeks, including a contemplation on the love of God, in which we stand in awe at the work of God in every dimension of our life, preparing to bring the graces of the retreat into the everyday world. So that's kind of a snapshot, a very brief intro to the exercises. And now I'm going to give you an equally brief snapshot into virtue epistemology. So let me do a little bit of opinion polling. How many of you have heard of the exercises? It's good that the director has heard of these. And how many of you have read them? Okay. And how many of you have gone through a retreat? Okay. And how many of you know what virtue epistemology is? This is a very well-informed crowd. Okay, yeah, okay. Well, epistemology generally is the study of knowledge, and virtue epistemology takes virtue as a central concept for our understanding of traditional epistemological problems. For example, justification and skepticism. So Tim and I had a professor named Richard Foley, and he was a very good epistemologist. And I think his entire, well, I shouldn't say this, but he seemed obsessed to me with this phrase, S knows that P. Right. So that was how traditional epistemology went for a long time. There were sentence letters, and we argued and fought over the sentence letters. And now virtue epistemology has sort of opened that up a little bit. It's given a different slant on traditional epistemology, but it's also charted new territory for epistemology. For example, you know, virtue epistemologists tell us about how intellectual virtues can help us become good knowers and how they relate to epistemic goods, such as truth, knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. And there are two big varieties of virtue epistemology. There are some hybrid theories, I will say, with a nod to Jason. Yeah. And the two kinds of varieties are reliabilism, according to which virtues are faculties or capacities, such as memory, attention, and perception. That's been put forward primarily by a philosopher named Ernest Sosa. And the way I read Sosa is that these are sorts of virtues in the sense of being excellences, right? In the sense in which virtue, the Greek term for virtue is arete, which meant or still means excellence. Okay? Now, attention, perception, memory can give us some kinds of knowledge, but they can't give us really higher knowledge. Perception doesn't give us knowledge of the theory of relativity, for example. Enter responsibilism. So responsibilism holds that virtues are traits such as open-mindedness, intellectual humility, curiosity, perseverance, and so on. What are the virtues of introspection, you may ask? Okay, so I came up with this phrase. I don't know if anybody else has, but here's what I think they are. I define them as the virtues that help us to explore and understand the interior landscape of the self, by which I mean our nature, character, personality, thoughts, desires, emotions, plans, and so on. So our natures as spiritual, religious beings are included in this landscape. So we might introspect on many different kinds of things. And when I say our natures, I mean sort of big, deep metaphysical questions. Like, who am I? What am I doing here? What is my role in the universe? That kind of thing. I don't mean things like, how does my digestive system work? We might introspect about that. We might think about it, but those are not the primary objects, I think, of introspection. When I think of introspection, I think about questions really about the meaning of life, about what I'm doing here, kind of deep, personal, psychological, emotional, metaphysical issues. So that's the sort of domain that I think virtues of introspection deal with. And examples of reliabilist introspective virtues are concentration, attention, perception of the self, for example, of what I'm feeling, and memory. Now, these virtues are not only virtues of introspection. Certainly, we can use memory when we're thinking about multiplication tables or other things. I don't want to suggest that the virtues of introspection that I've just listed are only introspective virtues. But I do want to suggest that they play a very important role in introspection and that they play very important roles within the context of the spiritual exercises. Perception of self is especially important. We live in a very unintrospective, or I should say, anti-introspective society, because we are constantly bombarded with stimuli from the outside. So, have we all gone to airports? Have we all had the wonderful experience of seeing the TV monitors with everything kind of bombarding you? Have we had the experience of hearing the public service announcements? If you see unattended baggage, dot, dot, dot. There are all kinds of stimuli that prevent us from being introspective. And when I see many people in airports with their headphones plugged in, I don't think they're introspecting. I think they're being distracted in other ways. One fun thing to do at an airport, if you're ever there, and I travel quite a bit, so this is something I do, is just people watch. And one of the great things is when you see people smile in an airport, it can really light up your day. Airports are not smiley kind of places sometimes. People are rushing. But when you see a person smile in an airport, that's a nice moment. And that, I think, is a kind of introspective moment in a way, because you're paying attention to somebody else, and that then affects your state. Now, if you can then reflect back on what that has happened to you, that's yet another step in the introspective process. So introspection is characterized by paying attention to something, a stimulus either external or internal, and then turning back on yourself to see how that has affected you. Concentration, perception, memory, attention, all part of that program. The next part of the program we find with responsibilist introspective virtues. And, you know, I don't have a list, really, of these, because I haven't really thought that deeply about what that list might look like. But these are just kind of commonsensical reflections on what introspective virtues help us to transform our landscapes in certain ways. So honesty, objectivity, careful mental review of one's own behavior, the love of learning, curiosity or inquisitiveness about the true nature of the self, the universe, and God, open-mindedness, intellectual humility, and perseverance. And this list I came up with by reading the exercises. Now, I say I haven't thought that deeply about them, because a truly deep thought about this would have to read numerous other texts to get pictures from other traditions. Buddhism has a lot to say about this. Hinduism has a lot to say about this. There are many other works in our own Western tradition that have a lot to say about this. So there could be introspective virtues from many other traditions, but these are the ones that I have discerned are operative in the exercises. And maybe you'll discern more, and maybe I'll discern more as we continue evolving in our thinking about this. So the thesis of the presentation is really that reading the exercises is not only a way of cultivating one's spiritual nature through, for example, the deepening of oneself as a spiritual being and the development of the virtues of faith, hope, and charity, but it's also a way of cultivating intellectual virtues and thereby developing one's capacities as a knower and seeker of truth. Now, in the context of reading the exercises, and people might say more generally, God guides the search for truth. So the search for truth in the context of the exercises is really a search for God. Okay, now, although the direct aim of encountering the exercises is spiritual growth, intellectual virtues are cultivated indirectly through the encounter. So by that I mean, I do not propose that a person going through the spiritual exercises or reading them on his or her own is doing it with an eye to becoming more intellectually honest or more intellectually humble. So I'm not proposing that anybody sits down with the exercises and says, okay, now I'm going to develop perseverance. Although I believe that in the course of going through them, you will, if you're successful in encountering the exercises. So I think the exercises encourage, and to be a little even more strong in my statement, I think they require the use of these virtues. So let's go through a few. I'm going to go take us through the whole exercises, not in excruciating detail, but in just enough detail. Moderation in all things. So the very beginning of the exercises is a foundation. So the first week, introduction to considerations of the end of man. The object of this study is to teach us the end for which we were created and to use the benefits of creation to achieve that end. We were destined to be with God. Thus, and this is from my copy of the exercises, which I forgot to bring. I always forget to bring something on trips. This time it happened to be the copy of the exercises. I realized this on the plane. Oh no. Okay, anyway, thus, even in this first meditation, the mind must concentrate its thoughts on itself. The principal point is to impress well upon your minds the truth of our final end. As the foundation supports the edifice, this first truth supports all others. So, you know, I've highlighted in red there what I think is really a point that underscores the point I was making earlier about introspection, right? The mind must concentrate its thoughts on itself. So you have to kind of look interiorly and see what you're thinking. There's a concentration of thoughts. There is a discipline of thoughts. Your thoughts don't wander. They don't meander. If they do, you bring them back. So here is my comment on this. Here in intellectual virtue, concentration is being used to set us on the right spiritual path, to look into ourselves, acknowledge and embrace our final end, and order our experience of creation to that end, instead of being distracted from that end by pleasure, wealth, etc. I did not mean to do that. Went in the wrong direction. Okay, so the first part of the text, the end of man, two truths. I come from God, I belong to God. We are led to see these truths through various techniques. So, I come from God. Ignatius asks us to consider a series of questions. For example, where was I 100 years ago? Well, 100 years ago, I was nothing. Right? Zip, zero, zilch. I belong to God. The Lord enters into judgment with me and deigns to argue his rights at the bar of his creature. These techniques lead us to the conclusions mentioned above. We need to have open-mindedness and intellectual humility to be led to these conclusions through Ignatius's use of these techniques. Right? I come from God, I belong to God. Those are the conclusions that Ignatius wants us to arrive at through thinking about things in a particular way. So Ignatius is taking us on a spiritual journey through appeals to our intellect and our emotions. My view is that our emotions will not engage unless we find the intellectual story compelling. So there is a mental discipline here. The mental discipline is needed for the engagement of the emotions. Now, we can have a discussion about this in Q&A, because I also think motivation is crucial. You have to want to do this. And you have to want to do it in a pretty serious way, because it's a very serious exercise. It's not pleasant. That is going to engage other intellectual virtues. So the first week, second exercise. Sin is punished in Adam and his posterity. Cowardice, with the lights of his intelligence, with the rectitude and good inclinations of his heart, with a conscience so upright and delicate, it was so easy for Adam to remain faithful. But we all know what happened. Adam didn't remain faithful. And intelligence and conscience are abandoned in vice and sin. Okay? Blindness. Adam and Eve were blinded by the devil's temptation to be as God and live forever. Their eyes were opened only at the moment of sin. Notice how often we equate the metaphor of seeing with knowledge. All right? Sin blinds us. Sin destroys our knowledge. Ignatius, have you not sought to deceive yourself by foolish reasoning? Again, intellectual virtues come up here, and intellectual vices. Foolish reasoning is a vice. It's not a good thing. Have you not sought to persuade yourself that sin is not such a great evil? Sin's not a big deal. Really, it's not a big deal. We can go ahead and do it. And Ignatius is saying, you know what? That's not right. You're deceiving yourself. That's another intellectual vice. So my comment here, blindness is a form of ignorance, self-deception, foolish reasoning, rationalization. All of these are intellectual vices, contrary to honesty, open-mindedness, intellectual humility, and so on. These vices lead us into sin. So one of the problems with sin is that it is an obscuring of the reason. It's also a corruption of passion, but it's certainly an obscuring of reason. And that's what I want to call to your attention. So blindness is a failure of our capacities for attention and correct perception. The sin isn't so great, right? The sin isn't so great because I want to do it. Motivation and intellect are entwined here. Adam, after his sin, so consider his faculties wounded, as it were, wounded mortally, his mind given up to doubt, ignorance, error, his conscience, which has lost its peace and is tormented by remorse. Behold the fruits of sin. Okay. Comment, sin disorders the mind and the heart. From a God offended by man and offended in all his attributes, you outrage his wisdom. By sin, you reverse the order of his providence, you turn creatures away from their end, and you destroy the harmony of the universe. How do you turn creatures away from their end? Well, you mess with their passions, but you also mess with their intellect. So a lot of this, this first part, is about what happens when you are disordered. We're still in the first week. This is a long haul. And we are now reflecting on hell. Okay. So this is not what you'd call a pleasant little light reading before bedtime. So the punishments of the reprobate through the powers of his soul, the torments of the imagination, memory, the understanding, the will. The first three of those are all about the intellect. Okay. These and other reflections, for example, on death and on venial sin, require perseverance and open-mindedness to read and seek to open oneself to unpleasant reflections on hell, sin, mortality, and the pains of being damned. For example, the habitation of the damned and the company of the damned. So if you ever read these exercises, a lot of them, it's just very graphic. Right? There's just a lot of graphic detail. And it's not fun, right? It's not fun reading. So what are you going to do? Are you going to stick with it? Well, you have to if you want to get the benefits of the exercises. You have to have perseverance and stick with it. And the thing is, you know, this is supposed to present to your mind in a very vivid way what sin does to people, right? And it's going to do it to you, right? It's clear that the appeal is very personal. It's not that, oh, there's somebody else who's going to, you know, sin and have all these problems. Oh, no, it's you. You're in this. So the end of the first week takes us through reflections on the prodigal son. So hope is given to those who return to the Father. So we end at the beginning of this reflection was that the end of man is God, right? So what happens in that first week is we go through a whole lot of things, many of which are about the unpleasant, horrible, disordering nature of sin, and we end on a note of hope. Okay, so, you know, there's an emotional trajectory here, and we're going to talk about that in a bit, but the emotional trajectory is through some downturns and then through some upturns, but it is through turning away from God that we become sinful, that we become vicious, that our minds become disordered, and then it's turning toward God that we get hope, that our minds are put at ease, that the torments of guilt and the conscience are over, that we can then start thinking clearly. But we get through this only by having certain virtues, only by being perseverant, by being humble, by being open-minded enough to be receptive to the message of the exercises that we are going through. The second week, the purpose is to propose to ourselves that Jesus Christ is the true way. The second week begins with a series of recommendations, many pertaining to mental discipline, about how to focus one's attention, what to read, and how to contemplate the mysteries of Christ. Guidance is offered for before, during, and after the contemplation. So you're being taken along a path, right? There is something that you are supposed to be following here. Here, as elsewhere, the practitioner must proceed with intellectual humility and open-mindedness. So intellectual humility and open-mindedness come up here because you have to be humble enough to say to yourself, I really don't know where this is going to lead. Okay? And you have to have some courage, too, because if you do this, you are grappling with yourself, with some dark forces in yourself, and you have to keep at it because this is a very rigorous examination of conscience. And it could present interior landscapes that you have that are not that pleasant to encounter. So it takes a lot to stick with it. So here's a telling recommendation about the beginning of the second week. To undertake the exercises with great courage and a sincere desire to follow the way of God, as it shall be manifested to us. This disposition is so necessary for the fruit of the exercises that it would be better to interrupt them than to continue them with an undecided will. So here's perseverance and resolve. Right? Okay, if you don't think you can do this, back out now. Because it's not going to be worth your time to do it. So it's a very serious exercise. You got to be committed. So this speaks not only to the need for intellectual courage, but also to perseverance as virtues needed to continue with the rigorous self-scrutiny required by the exercises. So here's some contemplations on the private and public life of Jesus Christ. Much of the second week invites a reader to contemplate the private and public life of Jesus Christ. For example, the circumstances of his birth and his early life growing up in Nazareth, and his public life preaching the gospel. The reader is invited to imagine in detail the circumstances of Jesus' life, what it felt like to be him, to enter into the physical, emotional, and spiritual being of Jesus through imaginative identification and application of the senses. So this requires mental discipline and a fidelity to the description of Jesus' life as presented in the exercises, by which I mean a commitment to represent to oneself those circumstances as faithfully as possible, to internalize them and enter into them. So what you're being asked to do is to enter into the life of Christ. So the virtues. The reader is asked to study the virtues that Jesus acquired in his early life in Nazareth. Humility, preference for obscurity to public life, detachment, indifference to wealth and comfort, joy and simplicity, charity, compassion for suffering and zeal for salvation of humankind, modesty, it regulates Jesus' behavior and demeanor, recollection, the elevation of the soul and the unification with deity, by which I think is meant, you know, you keep that in front of you all the time, you keep that in your mind. Perfection in the commonest actions, holiness of life in the sanctity of ordinary actions. So here is a little bit more on Jesus' virtues. So the reader is asked to reflect on Jesus' life and behavior and to discern his virtues. Obedience to God, modesty and comportment, humility, patience, charity, mildness, clemency, and compassion. So paint to yourself in your heart the conduct and whole life of Jesus Christ. This is an imaginative exercise. You put yourself in the life of Christ in a very detailed physical way. In all your actions, then, in all your words, lift your eyes to him as your model. This will inflame your love, increase your confidence, and help you to improve in virtue through imitating Christ. Here's a comment that I have on the acquisition of virtue. So what does it take for us to acquire virtue through the imitation of Christ? First of all, it takes God's grace, because we can't really do anything without that. Secondly, it takes purity of heart, the sincere desire to become virtuous. Thirdly, it takes willpower, the resolve to change behavior and mental states to become virtuous and perform virtuous actions. And finally, and I have this highlighted in red because, again, it is an illustration of the general theme about the virtues of introspection, accuracy in discerning what the virtues are and how they are enacted in daily life. If you get the virtues wrong, you are not going to succeed in this. You will fail. You need to get the virtues right. And in order to get the virtues right, you need to study the example of Christ. And, you know, ideally you do this with a spiritual director. You don't do it on your own. People do, but you know, I do think you're better off doing it with somebody who knows what they're doing to lead you through this, but you've got to get it right. You've got to understand what a virtue is and what being virtuous and acting virtuously amounts to in particular circumstances. So more on point four, the exercises guide us toward achieving this accuracy by requiring us to use our capacities, those reliableist virtues I mentioned to you before, such as attention, concentration, and perception, to read, that is to understand the virtues from Christ's life, that is to discern the virtues that he displayed in his daily actions. So he gives a model in his actions for what virtuous behavior is. What is it to be a good person? Look to Christ. Additionally, we need to have intellectual virtues, that is the traits, responsiblest virtues, to keep to the path that the exercises sets for us. We need to be open-minded, intellectually humble, intellectually courageous, and perseverant. And we need to have hope and a willingness to allow our interior landscapes to be reshaped by the intellectual, imaginative, and effective journey upon which we've embarked. So I remember a professor of mine at Marquette. I did my undergraduate and my master's work at Marquette, and then I went back to teach there. Very interesting, let me tell you. But I remember a professor using this phrase, docile unto the task. So you need to be docile unto the task here of allowing yourself to be transformed. I mean, that is part of it, that you put yourself in God's hands to be transformed. So examine yourself and make practical reflections. So this is a highly, in my view, a highly intellectual journey in the sense that you are required to think a lot and discern a lot and use intellectual virtues, but it is quite practical, right? So it is not a contemplation of the truths of mathematics that's completely divorced from reality. It's a contemplation of the life of Christ that is meant to have practical effect in your own life. So the third week is a meditation on the Passion of Christ, and the purpose is to confirm in the soul the resolution of a new life and in the determination to serve God better. So for this purpose, the meditation is on the Passion and Suffering of Christ, and it is a very graphic meditation. You know, you are supposed to put yourself in the situation of having your hands pierced with nails on the cross, of having a crown of thorns, of having your side opened up, of being taunted and vilified. That's what you're supposed to enter into. When you enter into the life of Christ, you enter into the whole life. You enter into the early private life, the public life of preaching, and then the Passion. You go through it with Christ. So here's what Ignatian says you need to look for in Christ as a model. In the loss of Christ's liberty, he gives an example of perfect resignation to the will of the Father. In the desertion of his friends who left him, he gives an example of perfect charity. In the loss of reputation, he gives an example of detachment. In the insults he endures, he gives an example of profound humility. In the torments of his body, he gives an example of penance. So there are examples in all of these things that we see Christ undergoing. The fourth week is a desire for a blessed eternity. So these are meditations on the resurrection and Christ's consolation of his followers. In heaven, there is no suffering, no change, no grief or sorrow, no separations, no temptations, no sin. Christ has no desire, no dread. The benefits of redemption are detachment from creatures and from ourselves. So we lay down our burden. Okay, so desolation and consolation are famous themes here. So a theme throughout is the alternation of desolation and consolation. We are desolate when confronted with our sins in the first part. At the end of that, we receive the consolation of hope through God. We are desolate when we are enduring the crucifixion, the Passion of Christ. We are consoled by being brought to resurrection. Okay? So desolation is a state of mind and being, a state of despair or hopelessness, brought about by the fallen condition of humankind, the temptations of the devil and humanity's turning away from God. Consolation is a state of mind and the state of hope, brought about by humanity's realization of the possibility of forgiveness, grace, redemption, and new life in Jesus Christ. Now, this is one reason why I would think the exercises are best done under the guidance of a director, because that desolation piece can be pretty darn desolate. You are going down in the dungeon of your soul. Right? You are going down to personal places that are very, very difficult to face. And it takes a lot of courage and perseverance to do that, and you need somebody to guide you through it, right? You need someone. And I'm not saying God can't do this, but I'm saying when you get down in that desolate place, you're going to need somebody human conveying to you God's desire and his will. That's just my personal opinion. Now, maybe folks have other views on it, but we can talk about that later. So intellect and will is another very interesting pair. In order for us to move from desolation to consolation, the proper exercises of two faculties is needed. And you know, in the classical tradition of philosophy, humans are composed of these two main faculties, intellect and will. So intellect, we need to recognize desolation and consolation for what they are. That is, we need to recognize the truth. Intellectual virtues are required for this. We need to recognize that the pleasures of the flesh, the pleasures of wealth, are the path to desolation. Okay? Desolation is not always, you know, wearing its desolate face on its sleeve. Sometimes desolation is prettied up in terms of temptations. And discernment allows us to see that trap. Okay. Do you go out gambling at the casino? Do you self-medicate with liquor and drugs? I mean, these are the kinds of questions, right, that can come up, right? Because you are going into desolation that way, okay? Desolation can be experienced in many guises. And we need intellect to be able to find our way through it. We also need will, because we need to resolve to do and follow through with what is needed to move from desolation, darkness, into consolation, light. Moral virtues are required for this. And of course, we can't do it alone. We need God's grace, and I think we need other people. We need a supportive community. We need the body of Christ on earth to help us with this. So the spiritual journey of the exercises involves intellect and will. It's a contemplative journey. Its appeal is first and foremost to the mind, and emotions are engaged by way of this appeal to the intellect. It's not an easy journey. We're asked to contemplate an array of themes in vivid detail, some of which are unpleasant, like those pertaining to Christ's passion. We're asked to review our own lives and conduct, not shrinking from acknowledging our sins and weaknesses. So we've got to be intellectually honest from beginning to end. It's a sustained journey lasting 4 weeks, which requires the person's total involvement. I'd say the 4 weeks of the exercises really are a blueprint for the rest of our lives. It's a way of living. It's a way of living our life that's given in very intense form in those 4 weeks. So the overall aim of the exercises is the transformation of the spiritual landscape of practitioners. So although meant to be used in directed retreats, it can be read by individuals who seek a deeper spiritual journey. They are meant to bring the reader closer to God by inspiring him or her to acknowledge and renounce her sins and resolve better to understand and imitate Christ. So you might say there are really two main things going on. That is, the acknowledgement of the sinful nature of the individual, and then the way out of that by the imitation of Christ, the model. So it has a holistic appeal here. The appeal is to the whole person. And, you know, in my view, it's a profoundly intellectual appeal, the success of which depends on the intellectual virtues of the reader. And by success, I mean the extent to which the reader benefits from her encounter with the exercises. Though appealing to the intellect, the exercises are profoundly practical. So the transformation of the spirituality of the practitioner is one that she herself must undertake through understanding, emotion, imaginative identification with Christ, and imaginative sensory experiences. Okay, so we were having a conversation this afternoon. I don't see where Jake went. Oh, there he is, moving around. So, you know, Jake had made this really wonderful comment about the exercises being sort of integrated. And, you know, it prompted me to think that, yeah, I think the exercises are integrated, and the appeal is to the whole person, the person consisting of intellect, motivation, affect, and then somatic or sensory experiences. So the whole person is this whole bundle of things. It's not just the intellect, but it's also motivation, emotion, physicality. Our physical being is brought into play through the very graphic descriptions in the exercises. But I think the linchpin here is this sort of intellect-motivation pair, that, you know, we have to want to do this, but we also have to have the intellectual capacities to do this. And that's where I think the virtues of introspection really come into play. So she must try to put herself into Christ's world. Her life then changes as Christ's being takes hold in hers. So you have to put yourself, I mean, this is putting yourself into Christ's life, experiencing what Christ experienced, and trying to do this through, you know, imaginative identification with what Christ went through. And then your life will change. I mean, that's the idea. You'll be transformed by taking on the role of Christ, taking on what was going on with Christ. There was a Jesuit priest at Marquette who would start prayers by saying, "We put ourselves in God's presence." And for many, many years, I never understood this, right? I thought it was always a little bit crazy, quite frankly. Because I thought, well, you know, God's here all the time. How can we put ourselves in God's presence? And isn't it a little bit hubristic to think that we can do that? But, you know, reading the exercises in this way, you know, it gave me some insight into what he meant. And that is, you know, we put ourselves in a place where we can be receptive to God and where we can hear God. So we turn off the noise. We turn off the static. You know, we don't look at the TV in the airport. We take off the headphones. And we just kind of focus our minds and let God's word and grace in. So my concluding comment here is that the exercises help us to put ourselves in Christ's life. Through the exercises, we put ourselves in God's presence in a deep and sustained way. Our intellectual virtues are necessary but not sufficient for this endeavor. That means we need them, but they're not enough. Their successful exercise, in my view, is the first and necessary step along the way. Thank you very much. You need this. Thanks. There you go.
Thank you. Yep. Thank you so much, Nancy. I'm going to moderate a Q&A session. I want to say a couple things before we get started. First, I want to thank you, and I want to say that I think what your talk did so well is to underscore how the terrain of the spiritual exercises is fraught with epistemic challenges or obstacles. Accuracy is important. Truth is important. Imagination is important. Awareness, perception. Those are all distinctively epistemic or knowledge-related ends or challenges. And when we step back and ask, okay, what do we need in order to meet those challenges? It's not quite moral virtue. It's not quite just a good heart or goodwill in the narrow sense. It's also not a matter of natural intelligence. Instead, what you've shown is that there's this intersection in the human person between character, agency, volition, action on the one hand, and the operation or conduct of the intellect on the other. And we need to have the excellences proper to that intersection in order to meet those obstacles and get the most that we can out of the exercises, which isn't primarily epistemic fruit, but the epistemic achievements and efforts and qualifications are an important step along the way. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Am I right that it's at Oklahoma where I observed that they allow students to raise questions first?
Yeah.
Maybe we've done that before here too. I don't remember, but why don't we do this? Why don't we let the first three or four questions be from students? So I'm going to put the pressure on the students. I don't see any of my students here, but I always point out this is an opportunity for you to become a little bit more intellectually courageous. Or a little bit less. I'm sorry, I've just put that weight on you. Yeah. Those of you who have thoughts, those of you who have questions.
Can I say one thing?
Yes, please.
Okay, now this is your chance to think of a question. All right, I'll babble a little bit here, and you can think of a question. But you know, I really appreciate your comments, Jason. Yeah. There's another virtue epistemologist named John Greco who has a book called Achieving Knowledge. And I think the thing about the exercises and the self-knowledge obtained through the exercises and the knowledge of God is that it's not like, you know, knowing a truth, right? It's not like, you know, I know that 2 + 2 = 4, and that's the end of knowledge. It's a process. It's an evolving process. So it's an achievement when you get even some of it.
Yeah. So really that was just an opportunity for several students to leave.
Oh.
Good try.
Oops.
Run away.
So please, thoughts, questions, particularly from students that are here. We'd love to hear them. Brian's raising his hand. Students in the broad sense. Okay. Yes.
He saw his hand go up.
Yeah. Thank you for your talk. An emphasis here is on inwardness and the virtues, epistemic virtues of inward. Mm-hmm. Some of us, however, experience things like self-loathing, self-deprecating, and we kind of are too far in that direction. And I was wondering if, in your thinking on this, direct somebody that's perhaps in the device of excess.
Yeah.
Too careful about eavesdropping on one's own thoughts and perhaps maybe too frequently being overly, well, maybe not overly honest, but perhaps just too often inward instead of being somebody who's, I guess, more of a outward kind of self-denying.
Thank you. Okay, I'm not quite sure that I understand what your question is getting at, because it seemed to me that there were two things going on there. One is that there was the idea of being self-denying and self-loathing, and the other was the idea of being too inward. Okay, and those are different things. I mean, there can be certainly be self-loathing extroverts, right? But I think in terms of the self-loathing issue, there is someone who whose knowledge needs adjustment, right? Because it gets to the question of intellectual humility. Okay, it gets to the question of humility. Now, some people think that humility is about owning one's limitations. I think that I agree with that, but I also think it's about having a realistic view of your strengths, and it's about viewing yourself appropriately in the creaturely order of things. So, in the sort of broader theistic perspective. So in the creaturely order of things, you are a child of God, right? You are God's creation. You are good, right? You have your flaws, right? But let's not get nuts about it. So the idea there would be, okay, you need correction. So don't focus that much on your faults. Focus more on your strengths. The focus on your faults could be a form of wallowing in self-pity. It could be a form of excessive self-centeredness, and maybe getting out of that inwardness and getting to be exterior a little bit more. Like, you know, the idea is just go out and help somebody, interact with somebody, okay? That will take your focus off these faults. So maybe that's the connection that you were making between the self-denying and the inwardness, is that maybe the focus outward, not on yourself, is what is needed as an antidote to that. So does that sort of answer your question? Okay.
Hi.
Hi.
So, I'm new to the virtue epistemology world.
Well, welcome.
Thank you. In the case of the moral virtues,
mm-hmm.
we're sort of helped along by our ability to look at people that are practicing courage,
yeah.
moderation, and so we can model our character based on them, we can be continent for a while and then hopefully reach the point of virtue through repeated practice.
Mm-hmm.
But the case of these epistemic virtues, it seems more difficult to look at other people as models. I don't know what the inner workings of someone else's mind are like to know what intellectual open-mindedness perhaps would be, or intellectual courage. So how can I look to other people as, or what sort of metric can I use to gain these intellectual or epistemic virtues?
Okay, good question. Oh, both these questions were good. Okay, but I'll bet you know people who are intellectually courageous.
Sure. I mean, yeah, sure. And
well, there you go. Well, there you go. I mean, you know them, right? So I don't know that there's all that much difference. I mean, you can look at somebody. Everybody knows the difference between somebody who is open-minded and somebody who is closed-minded. Okay? People know the difference between someone who is intellectually courageous and who is intellectually cowardly. I mean, you can see that, right? So those are the people you want to emulate. You know when someone has intellectual humility and when they're arrogant. That one is just very obvious, I think. Okay, so I don't really see that there's a big difference there, and I don't see that there's a problem. Now, how do you develop that in yourself? Well, that's another question, because some of the intellectual virtues, like some of the moral virtues, are not all that fun, you know? And Aristotle gives this account of, you know, habituating young children into virtue, and the idea there is that they take pleasure in the right sorts of things. But I think, for example, another way of stating that is to say, you know, there are some rewards that are intrinsic or internal to a practice, and there are some that are external, and that's the way that Alistair MacIntyre talks about it in After Virtue. And so just being an academic, we philosophers make fantastic salaries. Everybody knows that, right? So, and we go into, people go into it for the money. I mean, let's be very clear about this. You know, people go into it for the money. But, you know, if that were true, then we would be extrinsically motivated. But we don't. I mean, we know that, you know, philosophers are underpaid and overworked and all that stuff, and yet people still do this. And the question is why? And the answer is, I think we find it intrinsically rewarding. Right? So it might not be fun and games all the time, but it's something that is intellectually stimulating. And once you've been bitten by that bug, then, you know, if you just give yourself up to that love, then that will generate more and more of a virtue. So that would be how you get curiosity or inquisitiveness or even love of learning, that you're something that, you know, you really like doing. There's an intellectual pursuit that really you like a lot. And so that it becomes, it's a very rewarding kind of pursuit, quite apart from anything, you know, any payment you might receive. Does that make sense?
Yeah, sure.
Follow up?
It also seems that people find being closed-minded or something rewarding in its own way. Like, so it seems like there needs to be something outside of us that pulls us. And maybe that's why the exercises are a good example of how to develop these, because there's grace present.
Right. I think, you know, that's a very good observation. My guess is that closed-minded people are, some of them at any rate, are probably afraid of something. You know, they're afraid to be open-minded because they're afraid they're going to be changed in a certain way. And an open-minded person is more courageous or at least more flexible. So, you know, that response goes to the point that I think our characters and our personalities do not consist only of one virtue. They consist of a group or cluster of virtues that often interact together. And temperament and education have a lot to do with it. So, I mean, there's a whole complicated ball of wax here. And I wish I had an easy explanation, or even an explanation period, but I don't. But that's the best I can do to kind of gesture at this really complex landscape you've brought up.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. Oh, there's a gentleman over there.
Actually, I have two questions for you.
Okay.
First is, I need a really good Mexican restaurant. Could you tell us the name and the address?
I'll tell you.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean that.
Oh, you can't, you know, if you go to, this is not the restaurant we ate at, which is like the second best Mexican restaurant in Norman, but Pepe Delgado's on Asp in Norman, Oklahoma, number one in the world as far, you know, in my world, which is not too extensive, but.
You mentioned that this is a life-changing experience.
Yeah.
After you did this, what alterations in your life eventuated? Did you go to Mass more often? Do you, Tuesday morning at 10 o'clock, take 10 minutes aside? What alterations? Did you join a charity that you had thought to give back through? What, if anything, changed in the scenario of your behavior?
You know, I think I became less of a jerk. I mean, just generally. I mean, I just became less of a jerk. And this is just, this is a lifelong process, right? I got a little less impatient, right? I mean, I no longer have bouts of road rage. I don't. I no longer get mad at telephone menus, right? So there are these things that sort of can sort of drive you crazy, and they are so minor. They are so little. So like, why are you bothering with this? Why? So, you know, I try to be nicer to people. Now, I tell you, living in Oklahoma has had a very beneficial effect on me in this regard. They are the sweetest people you can imagine. And so I had to moderate my snarly personality because, you know, I mean, I'd just, you know, say things like I didn't think was a big deal. And, you know, anywhere else in the world, it wouldn't be. But in Oklahoma, it's like, well, I have never in my entire life. So, but you know, the thing is, I think basically it wasn't that I went out and did a charity. It isn't that I set aside time to reflect, which if I were a better person, I would. Right? But it's all part of the journey. It's just that I'm just less of a jerk than I used to be. I mean, and not that I'm a, you know, not that I'm a great person or a good person. I'm just a little less obnoxious, a little less cranky, you know, than I used to be. A little nicer, calmer. This is these things, these pressures that life puts on us that can kind of build up. You know, it's just, they're not that big a deal anymore. Yeah.
Any other student questions before we open it up to the energetic philosophers and others? Okay. Yeah. Paul, I see your name.
Here we go.
I want to quickly say something to you, Paul. This may come as a surprise. You are part of why this is happening today. You probably don't have any idea why. Because years ago when we were driving with Dan to LMU and I was telling you about the work that I was doing in intellectual character and education, you were probably the first person. Subsequently, other people said similar things, but you were the first person to say to me, oh, this sounds a lot like the Ignatian exercises and that stuck in my head, and then I heard it repeated a couple times, and then I decided to apply for the Taylor chair. So I'm so glad you're here. I wanted to not let you get away without mentioning that. So anyway, your question.
Good Lord, that in my whole day, but it was already made by your wonderful
Thank
talks.
You.
Thank you. That brings back a lot of good memories, and that's where I first learned about the virtue side of the talk. I don't have a clear way to formulate my question, but my experience with the exercises was very powerful and made me want to, I went and did research, and what I understood was the draw of it to me is the mystical side of Ignatius and the mystical Ignatian tradition side. So I kind of just would like to hear how this framework talks to that, those ways of knowing.
Yeah.
And specifically, the thing that I thought of was, I was trying to think about the language of discerning the interior movement of spirits and something that's very elusive and it's non-visual for me. So the blindness and the kind of correction, the disciplining of mind that you're talking about is one kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
There's that great quote, I think it's right in the beginning, that Ignatius says, it is not the abundance of knowledge that fills and satisfies the soul, but the to feel and taste matters interiorly. Mm-hmm. And that taste matters, feels kind of right in a way that the blindness doesn't. So I'm sorry, it's probably just a very general question, but I just wonder how the virtues epistemology side sort of grapples with or talks about the mystical side.
Yeah. Again, great question. Great question. And this something like this came up in our conversation earlier today. We talked about interpretations, and I don't grapple with interpretive issues. I should at some point. I'm going to have to. But I mean, the thing is, you can read the exercises in many ways, and this is a sort of a virtue epistemology framework. And the mystical framework is another framework. You can read it many other ways. You can read it as a journey. You can read it in terms of sort of the great literature in the Western tradition about the soul's journey to God. The mystical traditions are really interesting. From my own reading and my own view of this, I'm not at that mystical point. And I have to say I find it sort of repulsive. So there are parts of the exercises that I find very repulsive, very, very difficult. And I mean, that's all part of it. That's part of it. But, it's a journey. It's a journey. And, it sounds to me like you're farther along in yours than I am in mine, because this whole mystical thing is not something that I am not really equipped. I haven't done research on it. I sort of know vaguely that's who some of the mystics are and what they write about. But that's not an area that I've really, really thought about. To me, what I latch on to in terms of thinking about this really is Buddhism, because of the non-attachment, the overcoming of desires, the overcoming of afflictive emotions. That's what I sort of relate to in this. And the Buddhist approach to this in terms of mindfulness is very different from this Ignatian approach. The Ignatian approach really sinks you right into the stuff that is sort of, gory and detailed and difficult. Whereas the Buddhist stuff is just saying, put this desire outside and sort of objectify it and look at it from different angles. That's easier for me to do. The sort of, sensory and the somatosensory experience, that is much harder for me. But, that's the mystical way. That is the mystical way. And I think that there is room for both interpretations, which really, to me, speaks to the genius of the work and the flexibility of the work, that it can speak in so many different ways to so many different people from so many different angles and still have this sort of transformational value.
Can I just ask a really short follow-up?
It's up to him.
I think it's a question of, the kinds of knowledge and the experience of the virtues it takes to have them. So I didn't mean to sort of, so as an example, open-minded.
Yeah.
If there's one thing, I really love how you emphasize, if you commit to this, you open in a completely different way. And when you have open-mindedness, you don't just let more in.
Right.
You know differently.
Yes.
You feel differently. And that's the side where I feel like taste rather than blindness fits the kind of experience of openness that I had better. So I just want to say I was trying to get at the actual, to fit to the, it's cognitive and conscious thought. It's not mystical in that other sense. Like I think there's a really empirical side of the mystical that gets sort of lost in the discourse.
Just from the virtue perspective, I think there's an empirical, or do I want to say an embodied side of the virtues that is not fully investigated. Embodied virtues. What does it mean to be embodied and have the virtues? And, that hasn't been well investigated yet. That's one of the areas that is still, rife for study. So thank you.
So
there's a gentleman over there, too.
Gotcha. So I saw you initially raise your hand. I don't know if you still have a question, and then we've got Liz and Brian.
Sorry, there's another one.
If you've got another question, go ahead. Sorry.
Okay. There's another person.
So one thing that you said sort of along the way early on that I took to be more or less from the exercises was that sin obscures reason and corrupts the passion.
Mm-hmm.
I'm wondering if the formulation of reason as obscured fits with the kind of virtue framework that you're working on.
Mm-hmm.
So one way we might think of what we're doing in acquiring the intellectual virtues would be reforming something that is corrupt. Can we think of it as clarifying or de-obscuring something that is covered over? I'm not sure how to see that in terms of gaining virtues or shaping myself in terms of virtues. There's some sort of pure thing that's been covered over, and now the work of developing a virtue is somehow removing the cover from it. I don't see how that works, so I'm wondering if you can help.
Great question. One observation here. In vice, you know, if you have vice, then your reason is corrupted, because you have the wrong conception or mistaken conception of the good. Okay, so I would say that we are susceptible to, in sin, we are susceptible to vice, of course. And so I'd say vice would fall under the category of sin. But I think also the obscuring of the reason, in the sense that the reason itself is not corrupted, per se. So the reason itself is still oriented toward the good. It's just that something has gotten in the way of that. Something has gotten in the way of reasons leading us to the good. And it could be that that something is connected up with the emotions and the will. So I'm thinking here of self-deception, right? So, you know, I want to think of myself as a good, nice person all the time, and yet I have these, you know, times when I lash out, you know, at people. And so those are failing. So what happens there? I have to be ready to admit that I have these and not explain them away because of some self-protective desire, right? So that would be how I would explain that, okay? And it could be that that is a... That's an occasion of sin, right? It could be that that's an occasion of sin because I'm, you know, if I am self-deceptive in that way, I'm sort of putting myself above, you know, other people, right? And above my interactions with others. So that's a way of addressing your concern, I think.
Yeah, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Liz.
Oh, thank you very much. Mm-hmm. I came to this talk having just worked through a long chapter in a newly published book on ethics, dealing with discernment.
Okay. What book is that?
In the it's The Ethics of Discernment.
Oh, there you go.
And it has in the first part of it a section on Ignatius and how discernment is central to his spiritual exercises and to his thought. And I noticed that, by the way, you use the word discernment many times,
mm-hmm.
But discernment doesn't appear in any of your slides as a intellectual virtue or capacity.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just wondering if you've thought about elevating it from just something that you talk about in passing to an actual element that would appear in a virtue epistemology.
And I'm
not a virtue epistemologist myself.
That's okay.
So I don't know what reliableness or whatever kind of element it would appear at.
Yeah.
But you mentioned spirits, and that's where it comes up in Ignatius. He talks about discerning desolation, discerning consolation, discerning bad spirits, and discerning good spirits. And that whole effort
mm-hmm.
to discern is a really interesting thing to think about. And I wonder if you have more to say about it and how you fit it into virtue of this.
I have a little bit to say about it, but it's not very well formulated, okay? And I'm really glad you brought up that book, because I will get it and read it. I have thought that, here's how I think of discernment, okay? I think of it as a form of practical wisdom, right? Aristotelian practical wisdom. Now, I have skin in the game in terms of practical wisdom, right? So... Hence, I am not the impartial pursuer of truth, right? Because I have skin in the game. But now, but here's where I'm at on practical wisdom. I don't think practical wisdom is a separate intellectual virtue. I think it is an element, or I know, oh, are you with me? Oh, yeah, yeah. I think it's a necessary but not sufficient condition. That is, it's an element of moral virtues, right? It could be an element of some intellectual virtues also, in which case, when we are open-minded, intellectually humble, intellectually courageous, discernment is a part of that. I am assimilating it to Aristotelian practical wisdom.
Okay, good. I haven't made that connection.
So, but I will think more about it. The issue is by no means settled in my mind. I mean, I'm pretty settled on practical wisdom. It is, yeah. I'm willing to go to the mat for that one, right? But where discernment could be different, right? So, I mean, I'd have to do a lot more work about discernment than I have thus far.
I feel myself being desolate, mm-hmm. and I feel myself being inexplicably happy,
mm-hmm.
you know. So it's discerning what's causing that,
mm-hmm.
it's discerning
mm-hmm.
what that's rooted in.
Mm-hmm.
All that's part of my introspection.
Well, that's part of my introspection, too. And I have a very good friend who is a colleague at Marquette. And she is a very good Catholic and a very wise and good person. And she said at one point, she was going through a very tough time in her life. And she said, you know, there was a lot of darkness, but she was looking for light in the darkness. And I thought that was an incredibly good metaphor, But so often desolation, there's light in desolation. Or that desolation leads to light. But I thought that light in the darkness, I thought was just really deep and insightful.
Yeah.
Again, it's a seeing thing. I'm sorry. I just, you know. And then this gentleman, too.
I think I might be reformulating part of Paul's question here, but in a way that avoids the language of mysticism and maybe avoids the language of embodiment. Or carnality that could lead to some kind of situationalist kind of account of this. So I think I heard you say early on in the talk, in the first quarter or so, that the sort of right operation of the intellectual virtues is what allows us to feel emotionally this engagement in the process. Isn't it very often the other way around?
Mm-hmm.
That it's our mm-hmm. emotions mm-hmm. that dictate how we think and,
mm-hmm.
and even to some degree what we think and believe.
Mm-hmm.
And so that it's actually starting with, in Paul's language, our embodiment, or in the language just of the virtues, our emotions, they've got to be ordered right, or at least pointing us in the proper direction for any of these intellectual virtues to even operate the way they ought to operate, for them to aim at the right objects, for them to for you to have the right kind of practical wisdom or phronesis to be able to judge the mean, all these sorts of things.
I think that's true. And I think... let me just try to clarify where I was coming from.
Sure.
But I think you're making a really good point. And the point is that when we're talking about somebody successfully reading the exercises, by which I mean, you know, experiencing some sort of personal transformation, personal spiritual transformation, I believe the intellectual virtues are crucial to that. However, in the background there, I'm presupposing a well-ordered person, right? I'm presupposing that somebody is coming into this who is not going to be blocked or impeded through some sort of emotional blockage, right? So that's the presupposition there. If you don't have a well-ordered person who's starting this, then I think you've got to do preparatory work before you get into it. I think you have to get a person to a place where they can actually begin this and then benefit from it, right? That's just my opinion of it. I mean, I don't know a lot about this. Okay, I don't know a lot about how the psychology works, about how it's done. I would be, you know, if someone is really troubled, I wouldn't put them through this. I mean, I'd do some work before that.
I think it's a testimony to the quality of your presentation that the answers that you've given to some of the questions have raised more questions for me. I mean, I'd like to argue about practical wisdom and discernment, but I'll just limit to one question.
Okay.
It seems to me that virtue ethics and virtue epistemology bring some new questions to the interpretation of the spiritual exercise, and you've illustrated that. And one of my questions was going to be, are there even more specific virtues, intellectual or moral, that are named in the spiritual exercises that you didn't cover? So one of them would be discernment and how to figure out, but another would be in the foundation of indifference.
Yeah.
And I was just wondering what you thought, how would you categorize indifference as either moral or an epistemic intellectual virtue?
Okay. Another great question. Explain what you mean by indifference.
Well, in the foundations, we're encouraged to be indifferent to riches,
yeah,
and health,
right,
and honor.
Right.
And that indifference is supposed to then help us to attain, again, earlier in the foundation, piety and obedience to the Lord. To
right.
Recognize our human nature as creatures. And so would you say that in that notion, that Ignatian notion of indifference is an intellectual virtue, or as you're understanding it, or is it in some way a moral virtue?
Okay. There is an easy and unsatisfying answer. And then there is a harder and unsatisfying answer. Okay. So
I'm indifferent.
The easy and unsatisfying answer is that intellectual virtues are, you know, directed toward the attainment of epistemic goods. So that's a sort of boilerplate. Okay, and that's just useless, I think. I mean, it's okay, but it's not going to help with this question, right? So that's the easy, unsatisfying answer. The harder, unsatisfying answer is that really it's kind of hard to figure out if there is a hard and fast line between an intellectual virtue and a moral virtue. Because some, I mean, philosophers have been onto this. But also, if you're looking at a text like this, it's clear that Ignatius was not saying, oh, this is where a moral virtue is going to help you, and this is where an intellectual virtue is going to help you. So I would be inclined to say that indifference, in the sense in which you describe it, is both an intellectual and a moral virtue. And that at some level, because we are integrated people, the intellectual and the moral virtue distinction is going to be not helpful for us. So I would say indifference probably is both an intellectual and a moral virtue. Intellectual in the sense that it relies on a recognition, right, that these things are not worth attachment. And moral in the sense that it requires commitment, will, to follow through with that recognition.
We have time for one last question.
Okay, so my question is following up kind of off Brian's question. So as you're going through this, you kept saying emotion a lot, and I was thinking about kind of the role of emotions in this whole picture, and Brian pointed out how they come in beforehand, before reasoning. I was thinking about them in terms of as being the object of introspection. Right? When you're introspecting on yourself, you're thinking about your intellectual abilities and how open-minded you are, how humble you are. You're thinking about your will. You're also thinking about your emotions, right? So mm-hmm. I was saying, you know, you feel happy suddenly, or you feel really sad, right? That seems like it's an important part of the, I don't really know the spiritual exercises, but that seems like it's an important kind of insight that you can draw from being introspective as you're going through them. So I was just wondering if you're going to say more about that.
Yeah, I think that the emotions are one of the very important objects of introspection in the exercises, because we are led on an emotional journey, right? And part of that emotional journey is to understand what we are feeling and why, right? And then to become a part of that story or that landscape. So yeah, you know, if at a certain point, that is a lesson in life, right? Because, you know, you're using these virtues of introspection, or you're introspecting as you're reading the exercises, and you're going through the section on the Passion of Christ, right? And it's hard, right? It should be a hard thing, right? You should experience a lot of negative emotions, right? This is not a feel-good read, okay? So then the lesson in life is then, okay, well, what is it that these emotions are leading me to? And in that story, then you're led through the Passion to resurrection. And so then in your life story, okay, you are experiencing, say, emotion, sadness, something has got you down. So then you introspect that. And what is this leading you to? So you have the model of the story of Christ's Passion and resurrection to draw on. But you also have this model that will help bring you through this introspection on these negative emotions. And the other part of this, I think, is that it endows us with a certain kind of confidence and courage that when we face, you know, we can face these emotions, which are really scary sometimes. I mean, they're really scary, and you know that, you know, you can come out of it. You'll come out of it. So it's okay. I mean, that's a lesson in Buddhism, too, in a very different way. That, you know, these emotions are, you know, okay, they're here, fine, we embrace, they're part of life, they're a part of what we do, but we know that we are not alone, and we'll come through it. Oh, he has a follow-up.
Just a quick follow-up. It seems like that kind of circles back on itself to answer Brian's question a little bit, right? Because then if you're introspective towards your emotion and you're learning about that response, that can then help set you up for having the intellectual virtues going forward.
Right. And I agree with that, but I think, you know, as I responded to Brian, I think that if a person is very troubled, is very emotionally troubled, that they need some work before they start doing this.
Anyway. Please join me in thanking you. It looks like there's still plenty to eat.